In these next two videos, I wanted to cover the design of really large caches. So, you know, we've already seen that you can have, let's say, an L1, L2, L3 hierarchy on your chip. And this L3 cache in this case would be referred to as the last level cache or the LLC. And these LLCs tend to be really large. So I'm showing you an example over here from a slightly older chip where all of these blue regions constitute your L3 caches. So there are two 12 megabyte L3 caches. So and as you can see over here, it takes up more than half the entire chip area. Okay, and because of their really large size, there are a couple of peculiarities for these L3 caches that don't show up when you design the L1 and L2 caches. Okay, so I'm going to cover at least, you know, two of these very important design issues. One of them is referred to as non-uniform cache access, and the second one has to do with whether you implement these large caches as private or shared structures. Okay, so let me first look at this issue about, you know, private versus shared. Okay, so I'm showing two different designs over here. The one on the left is a private L2 organization, and, you know, just to keep the discussion simple, I'm assuming just an L1, L2 hierarchy. And the design on the right has a shared L2 cache. Okay, so I'm assuming that I have a total of 1 megabyte worth of storage space for the L2. On the left, I've implemented 4 L2 banks, each of size 256 kilobyte. Okay, whereas on the right, I have, you know, one large 1 megabyte L2 cache. Okay, so let's walk through the design on the left first. Okay, so, you know, I have 4 processing cores, P1 through P4, and you will see that each one is associated with its own private L1 cache. And it almost never makes sense to implement a shared L1 cache among many cores. Okay, and there are multiple reasons for this. Firstly, this L1 cache is touched basically every single cycle or every other cycle by the processing core. Okay, so if there were many cores sharing an L1, then you would have, you know, several requests showing up over here, and you would have to build a heavily multi-ported L1 cache. The second reason is that you know, you also want your L1 caches to be servicing requests within a single cycle. Okay, but if P4 has to travel a long way to reach a shared L1, then, you know, you're adding a few cycles of wire delay, which increases the cost of that L1 access. Okay, so for these reasons, you know, almost always you'll see a private L1 cache, which is very tightly coupled to your processor. Okay, and it's a fairly small structure that can be reached within a single cycle. Okay, now if you have a miss in L1, in this case, what I'm doing is I'm associating a private, you know, 256 kilobyte L2 cache bank with that L1. So that's the first structure that gets looked up. If I have a miss in this L2, then I may have to go off chip. But before I go off chip, I also have to check to see if I can find a copy of that block in one of these other L2 cache banks. Okay, so for example, if there's a copy of A sitting over here and P3 has done a write into this block, that's the most recent and most up-to-date copy of A. Okay, so if I have a miss for L2, I need to send out a broadcast saying I'm looking for A. Every other cache is going to, you know, snoop on this bus, and the private L2 bank for P3 is going to say, yes, I do have a copy of A, which is the most up-to-date copy. And so here is the value of A that you're looking for. Okay, and so then you end up keeping a cache copy of A over here. And if P3 does not have a copy of A, then the request goes off to memory. Okay, so we'll talk, you know, more about cache coherence much later, but this gives you a sense for, you know, what needs to be done with the private L2 cache organization when you do have a miss in your private L2. Okay, now let's move to the design on the right. Okay, so instead of having a private bank associated with each core, there's just one large monolithic structure which is kind of centralized. Okay, so if I have a miss in my L1, I'm going to send the request to this L2. There's a small cache controller over here which receives the request. Then, you know, there'll be a unique copy of A sitting over here. That then gets returned back to P1. Okay, and if you have a miss, if the data is not in L2, then you go straight to memory and you don't have to look up any other structures. Okay, so what are the main differences between these two designs in terms of behavior and performance? Okay, the first advantage of using a private cache is it has low access times to reach the L2. Okay, so, you know, this 256 kilobyte structure may take, say, you know, 10 cycles to access. So, you know, within 10 cycles, there's a good chance that you'll get your data back. On the right, since my structure is 4 times as big, its latency for access is also going to be higher. So usually the latency is, you know, varies as square root of capacity. So since the capacity is four times as much, the latency will be two times as much. So looking up this 1 MB structure is going to take roughly 20 cycles. In addition to that, I have to traverse these long wires to get to the centralized cache controller. So that could be a few handful of cycles. And also, you know, this structure is being accessed by multiple different cores. So there might be contention. You may have to wait in a queue before you can begin your own L2 lookup. Okay, so because of these additional cycles, you know, looking up the L2 cache on average could take, you know, let's say 25 cycles. Right, so 25 versus 10. So clearly the private L2 cache is much quicker to access than the larger shared L2. The advantage of using the shared L2 cache is it's going to have higher hit rates. Okay, and again, there are a couple of reasons that contribute to these higher hit rates. So one is that if you look at the figure on the left, you'll see that there's a copy of A over here, there's a copy of A over here. So essentially, the private L2 organization allows you to have duplicates within the aggregate 1 MB L2 cache space. Right? So if you look at this entire space, you are seeing some duplicate copies of data. So the total net capacity is not quite 1 MB, it's actually a little less than that. Whereas on the right, you know, every block is going to have a unique cache copy, right? This is one single cache structure. This block A is going to be placed in exactly one unique location, and you won't have duplicates. So you actually do have the entire 1 MB of space available to you. Okay, so that's going to contribute to a higher hit rate. The second reason where L2 does better is it can do a better job allocating space among the many cores. Okay, so the figure on the left does a static allocation. It says that, you know, I'm going to assign exactly 256 kilobytes to core P1, exactly 256 kilobytes of cache to core P2, and so on. Okay, but if the thread running on P1 has a working set size of, say, 384 kilobytes, it needs a lot of cache space. But all I'm giving it is 256 kilobytes, right? So correspondingly, there's going to be a high miss rate for this thread, whereas P2 might have a working set size of only 128 kilobytes. Okay, so P2 instead is going to underutilize the 256 kilobytes of cache space assigned to it. Okay, whereas if both of these threads were running with a shared L2 cache, you know, based on the LRU policy, you know, the space in the cache would be allocated across different threads. You know, blocks that are used a lot will occupy more space in cache, and a thread that does not need many blocks will not occupy a large space in cache, right? So this entire space will get dynamically allocated. You know, P1 will be assigned all the space, P2 will be assigned this much smaller space. Okay, so you know, because of these reasons, your shared L2 cache does a much better job of keeping the most useful blocks and thus yielding a high hit rate. Okay, so there are other more subtle differences as well. Some of it will be made clear when we discuss cache coherence issues, but to a first order, the main difference is that a shared cache gives you, you know, better hit rates, and the private cache gives you, you know, better latencies and better access times. Okay, so, you know, by the end of these videos, I will also give you an example of a design that tries to combine the best of both worlds. So it tries to present a physical structure that has low access times, but it also presents a logical structure that gives you higher hit rates.